See if you can make a smashing performance here. Click, three, four, five, six, seven.
And welcome. I am Maurizio Caschetto, editor of the Legacy of John Williams website. Today, I'm very honored to host a very special video event. It's a celebration of John Williams' music as a scene from the eyes of some of the greatest Los Angeles studio musicians, or as we call them, the LA studio legends. All of them have been already guests of our podcast series, but today, they're gathering together, I think for the first time since many years. They are some of John Williams' favorite first chair musicians who performed in dozens of his film scores recorded in Los Angeles. So before introducing our guests, I want to welcome my dear friend, partner, and head contributor of the Legacy of John Williams, Tim Burden. Hello, Tim. Nice to have you here.
Such a pleasure and a thrill and a privilege to be here with these iconic musicians who have, you know, really changed many of our lives through their playing. So great to see you all.
So without further ado, let's introduce our esteemed guests. So first, we have a musician who has been called by John Williams as one of the greatest flutists in the world. She played for the maestro for many, many years and got to play some exquisite solos in scores like Hook, Jurassic Park, and War Horse. So please welcome Louise Di Tullio. Hello, Louise, and thank you for being here.
Hi, thank you for having me. Appreciate it.
So then we have another legendary musician who performed in thousands of film scores. He started to play for John Williams in the late 1960s and stayed until the early 2000s, performing piano and keyboards. He played the most iconic piano solo ever written for film, the end credits of E.T., the extraterrestrial. So please welcome pianist and keyboardist Ralph Grierson. Hi, Ralph. Thank you for being here.
Hi. Hi. Pleasure to be back with you. Visually this time, that's interesting. I don't know if I have anything more to add other than everything we talked about. We talked for a long time, and it was a great experience. But I'm sure our memories will get jogged with everyone else here.
Yeah, totally, totally, absolutely. So the following guest is one of the most known and longest serving musicians for John Williams. He's another superstar among studio musicians in LA and performed in more than 40 projects with John Williams and also more than a thousand of film scores. So when you hear a powerful trumpet sound in many John Williams films, like The Arrival on the Island of in Jurassic Park, for example, it was him leading the section. So please welcome the great Malcolm McNab. Hello, Malcolm. Thank you for being here.
Well, the only thing that's happening new with me and everything I got is old, actually, but this, next year is my 70th anniversary of as a trumpet player, 1952 to 2022. So I'm going to try to do something special, commissioning a few little pieces to record for it and re-release a few of my things I've done. And so it's sort of lonely here, but, you know, I got all my toys. And that's what goes on now. But anyway, I have a lot of memories. I think I started in 1972, 73, something like that. And all through maybe 2011. So that's about 40, 45, 46 years, something like that. No, not that long. I'm not good at 39 years, I think. That's, yeah.
Yes, it's a pretty long. It's yeah. a pretty long.
Been a long, it's been a long since I did the arithmetic. So, you know.
No, thank you for being here, Malcolm.
Thank you.
And so the phone guest, he's best known to John Williams fans as the voice of the mothership because of his world-famous tuba solo who stood for the aliens during the iconic conversation sequence in Steven Spielberg's Close Encounters of the Third Kind. So he served as first tuba for John Williams since 1990, and virtually all of John Williams' scores were recorded in LA until recently. So please welcome tuba legend Jim Self. Hello, Jim. Thank you for being here.
Hello. Thank you all. And it's so great to see all these other young faces around me here that I haven't seen in person for a long time. It's just I want you to know that I think that I'm the luckiest guy in the world to play with these great musicians.
So the next musician is perhaps the one that got to know John Williams before than anyone else here, I think, and also ended up being his preferred principal flute for many years. You can hear his marvelous playing in scores like E.T., Jaws, and The Witches of Eastwick, among others. So please welcome flutist Sheridon Stokes. Hello, Sheridon. Nice to be here.
Hello. I'm delighted to be here. I'm glad the whole system worked, too.
Great That's to see fantastic. You, Sheridon.
Yeah.
So you heard his iconic French horn solos in movies like Always, JFK, Jurassic Park, Sleepers, Amistad, among others. He's been John Williams' favorite French horn player for many, many years, stepping into the shoes of the legendary Vince DeRosa. So we are glad to have again with us the great Jim Thatcher. Hello, Jim. Thank you for being here.
It's great to be here. It's great to see everyone. There's so many... this is tugging at my heartstrings. I remember Sheridon never uncrossed his legs when he played his flute solos. and Jim and Malcolm, just rock solid players. I admired them so much. And I was there with Ralph at the E.T. concert when he, I was a few feet away from you, Ralph, when that infamous day happened. I'll never forget that. And Louise, I just finished a Pops concert with the Pasadena Pops, and Sarah Weiss was playing beautifully. And I leaned over to her and I said, I thought I was listening to Louise today. And she looked at me and said, you just gave me the greatest compliment I could ever ask for.
That's so very just, sweet.
Yeah, I'm thrilled to see all of you.
Oh, Jim, fantastic.
That's really? Absolutely lovely.
Lovely.
It's going to be very emotional, I think, for all of us here today. So last but not least, we have a musician who played in the violin section for John Williams for several years, including such iconic scores as Jaws and Close Encounters of the Third Kind. And then he went to have a great career as a conductor. He often conducts live concerts featuring John Williams' music and has developed a great insight of John's music on both the music chair and the podium. So please welcome Richard Kaufman. Hello, Richard. Nice to have you here too.
Hi, everybody. Well, you know, as I'm looking at these faces and remembering how I sat somewhere in the violin section in awe, listening to Malcolm's solo on Jaws, and thinking, boy, am I glad I'm not a trumpet player.
Oh, the promenade cue, yes.
You know,
yes.
And these folks really are legends. And I remember George Gobel, a comedian on The Tonight Show, when Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin and Sammy Davis Jr. walked out, George Gobel said, did you ever feel like the world was a tuxedo and you were a brown pair of shoes? Well, I feel like that right now. It's something where when I started playing in the string section, I always wanted to be a conductor. And so I was always looking at the entire orchestra and listening, and I would sneak into the booth on breaks and listen to playbacks and all that sort of thing. But I would look around and I would see Malcolm and Louise and Sheridon and Jim and Ralph. And I would think, geez, I get to be in the same room with them, much less to be in the same orchestra. And as I've gone on to conduct a lot of John's music, I base a lot of what I do, what I'd like the orchestra to sound like, on what you all created. And And it's just, it's very exciting. You know, when I think of John, I think of the word humility. Through all these years, if I'm doing a concert, sometimes he'll ask, he'll want to know what I'm programming. And he'll sort of, you know, are they, you really going to do a concert of all my music? And I'm, you know, I mean, the answer is the difficult part about programming a John Williams concert is what not to do, because there's so much and it all is just brilliant in concert. And then being able to go on the last few years and conduct the entire film scores of all the Star Wars films and Jurassic Park and E.T. It's sort of, I often think back sitting in the section and looking around at, you know, Ralph and everybody and Louise and thinking, wow, you know what, I get to do this live with an orchestra. And so it's a thrill to be here. I just I'm going to do more listening than talking.
I think one of the lovely things, just to elaborate slightly on what Richard said there, and I've had the real immense privilege to work with Richard a few times over the years, and I love his terminology when it comes to conducting a film live to picture. He says, you know, to the audience, it's such a lovely way of putting it. It's like the audience is attending a Hollywood film session, essentially, because obviously for all of you, it's such a private thing, film sessions, other than the odd time you'll get a camera crew, but it's so special. And of course, what Richard's unique audacity is when it comes to, you know, the musicality and the performance is, you know the way some conductors tend to kind of want to do their own thing and put their stamp on it, but Richard is so, you know, true to the music, and he wants it to be as John Williams does. And it's such a key thing, I think, to highlight. So I know all of you know this, but I just thought it was worth saying. But it's,
thank you, Tim.
Not only that, Richard brings a sense of humor to that podium. Lots true. Of fond memories of concerts with the Pacific Symphony. Yeah. And Richard, John's made it easy for you in recent years. He just writes a cue and beginning to end, it's done. Just That's take right. it straight out of the score to the stage.
Yeah. And one of the topics you might want to even talk about with everybody is how well he writes for every instrument and how it's on the page. And you know, he knows everything in terms of writing for the instruments.
Yeah, and he pushes us to our limits too.
Yes, he does.
I just will say in the latter years, as we've been able to get music ahead of time, unfortunate for us because he knew we could practice, and it just got harder and harder and harder.
Absolutely. You know, it also reminds me, it's important to interject here because it's relevant, is another thing which whenever Richard is rehearsing with orchestras, he would often have them all play individually as sections. Similar, I suppose, maybe sometimes in the session environment, but it's so key because it gets the rest of the orchestra, you know, to hear what each section is playing. You know, I think the term you use, Richard, is you would obviously say it better than me, but it's like a busy city above, but then below it's like a, you know, busy subway. Have I got that right?
Well, sort of. Yeah. I mean, what there's the melody, and what's going on underneath is brilliance. There is it goes so far beyond counterpoint or anything like that. And to me, obviously the key to being in an orchestra is listening to the rest of the orchestra and making it all come together. And with John's music, there is so much to be aware of. And a lot of times, because of the challenge of playing your own part, you know, your attention doesn't always go to, you know, if you're a string player, what are the woodwinds doing? What are the basses doing? Which is often the motor of John's music, I think. And so I like to sort of take it apart and say, you know, woodwinds, play this section. It's not for you to play it. It's for the rest of you to hear it. And after that, it really comes together because John, it's just all of these pieces of this brilliant puzzle. And if you're aware of them, it just makes what you're doing a lot more fun.
I'd love to try to go on a kind of a time travel machine and go back in time to maybe to put things in a wider context here, because I think one of the things that is very essential to understand better John's musicianship is the fact that he started back in the 1950s as a pianist Initially, he studied at the Juilliard School of Music to become a concert pianist, but then when he returned to Los Angeles with his family, he decided to become a session pianist. So he both for recordings and then for film session. So he started to play for the great Alfred Newman at 20th Century Fox in movies like Carousel and South Pacific, for example. But he also played for Franz Waxman and Dmitri Tiomkin and Bernard Herrmann, to name a few. So we can say that he started his career in Hollywood as a studio musician and immediately became accustomed with that environment. And that is probably something that helped him to become the composer that he would become later. And I think also the fact that Hollywood orchestras back then were mostly formed by European emigres who established in LA between the two world wars and brought the kind of musical tradition of the great European classical music with them and also the style of playing. And I think that is something that really ties to John's style as well, is something that would become essential in some of his movie music. So I want to involve Louise here because, and also Sheridan, because both of you started very early and very young to perform as studio musicians in Hollywood.
Well, I had quite a history with John. I first met John in the 50s. We both had a mutual friend. John knew him in the Air Force, and he was a bassoonist. I played the Carmel Bach Festival with him. He was John's good friend. So I was about 22 and I think John was about 25. So that goes back quite a ways. I was under contract with Fox at the time. And so that was the first time I met John. He was over at his parents' house in the Valley. And then after that, I think the first thing I remember, it was a TV show called Lost in Space. And we went out to lunch one day and came back and to nothing but a page of black notes. And Abe Morse and I were looking at this in amazement. But and John used to love to write lots of notes. So that was the first experience. And then after that, I did a number of things with him. But one thing I have to say about John is whenever you worked for John, it was an event. It wasn't just a recording session. You were very happy to be there. We liked him. We all got along. We admired his precision, amazing precision when he conducted. Every little detail was there. And then I'll never forget when we were doing Jaws and the very first time John heard it and saw it on the screen, I was sort of looking at his face and he didn't know what it was going to sound like or what it was going to look like. So I've done all sorts of things for John, but really admire him. One day I asked John, I said, how do you write music? And he looked at me, he says, I don't know. I thought that was the most profound answer anybody could give. Because anybody that like John, who's that versatile, John, you never know what he's going to write. Could be any style. Where most composers, they have several styles and that's it. But John just never knew what it was going to be. So his answer made perfect sense. He didn't know. You know, the same thing if you're a performer, if you're really a good performer. You don't know what it's going to sound like. You're going to interpret it different every time you play, you know. But anyway, I've known John all these years and really admired him. And he honored me with asking me to premiere his flute concerto, which I did in 1974.
Amazing. Long history with John and so many iconic movies as well. So Louise, do you remember becoming aware of John's as a musician, as a pianist back then, or do you start to know him only afterwards when he was already a composer?
I don't think I started working for him until the days of the, I can't think of the word now, the tragic movies. The
disaster movies.
The disaster movies, thank you very much. Yeah, I think that's where I came in the section, and I believe Arthur Glickhorn was probably playing first flute at that point as well. But it was... Even then, it was a privilege to go and work for him. And it was obvious where that career was going. I mean, he just skyrocketed from beginning to end. He's not done yet.
But he's not. And do you know if your father, Joseph Di Tullio, who was a great cellist and played in the 20th Century Fox Orchestra So, you know, Louise, your family has a great legacy of its own. I mean, it's built upon the great legacy of the great studio play in Hollywood and Los Angeles, and not just for the movies. Do you know if your father, Joe, ever played for John?
Not sure. I don't remember ever having that conversation. I don't think John was in the Fox Orchestra, was he?
I think he was freelancing. I think he was freelancing. I think he was mainly at Columbia, but then he started to freelance a little bit. And I mean, he said several times about playing under Alfred Newman.
The only name I remember, and Sheridan will know it, Urban Thielman, who is the pianist of Fox. Am I right, Sheridan?
Yeah, Urban Thielman was the pianist, and then he became the orchestra manager.
Correct.
The piano player after that was actually my piano teacher, Lou Morey, became the pianist in 59. And then the contracts were up. So I remember seeing John on stage. I can't remember him playing in the orchestra, though. Maybe he did, because I worked on South Pacific, but I somehow don't remember him playing. But I remember seeing him walking around, being in the booth, being around.
If he had the opportunity, I'm sure he was there soaking it up.
Yeah.
Yeah, everything he could learn.
So he grew up in that environment, you know.
And I think Louise, Sheridan, and Ralph Grierson, where you were all there for The Reavers in 1969, which was really truly a turning point for John's career, because it was his first Oscar nomination for Best Original Score, because before that he only got nominations for Adaptation, if I'm correct. And that score inspired a very young Steven Spielberg to pen his first movie script, The Sugarland Express, another score in which many of you played. So, Ralph, do you remember anything specific about your very first sessions with John?
I remember it being at the old Warner Brothers stage before they built the booth. I think Dan Wallen was the engineer. And the most significant thing was it was the first time, I was fairly new in the business, but I had already played the score under Lalo Schifrin, who had scored it first, and then they threw his score out. And so I was coming to it, having already done it, and that was something that happened, I guess, quite a bit in my career later. It seems that you really haven't arrived as a composer until you've had a score thrown out.
That's right.
And it had nothing to do with the quality of the music. I'm sure Lalo's score was just fine. Producers and directors, they play it for different people, or suddenly they have a different idea of what it should be, and suddenly there's no problem. They just say, well, instead of asking the original composer to rewrite it, they say, no, we need somebody else, and they get it. So all I remember is that it was as every John Williams score was, it was very special in that here was a guy who clearly was a cut above the norm in terms of a conductor. Most composers, film composers, conduct because they have to or because it's valuable for them to be there to hear their music, but they're not trained as conductors. John was just already a masterful conductor. He was clearly a great musician, and so that gets everybody's attention. So everybody is on high alert when you've got somebody who is that clearly that knowledgeable and that good.
And standing on that podium, there is nothing he doesn't hear. That's especially anything a wrong note. I mean, you feel like you're under a microscope or something every minute you're there. It's uncanny how much he can hear.
Well, he's very detailed. That's one thing he knows about how he conducts. Every little detail is important. And most composers are not like that. They're happy just to get through it and do a pretty good job. And a few of the composers, interesting, like Hugo Friedhofer, when we did Boy on the Dolphin at Fox, he couldn't conduct at all. And finally, not Lionel.
He never stopped trying.
And Lionel, who was Alfred's younger brother, did most of the conducting of Fox, just gently came up in behind Hugo and said, "Do you mind, Hugo? May I take the baton?" And Hugo looked at him and said, "Oh, please do." So I think John learned from that. I mean, you really have to be a good conductor if you're gonna write a score conductor. You can't just get up there and beat time. It doesn't make sense because there's so many details that you have to take care of.
The other thing I always noticed about John was his time management during a recording session, how he always knew how to protect the musicians, especially the brass, because there were a lot of notes, a lot to play, and he didn't want to, tire them out while he went over and over and over, something like that. And I learned a lot, frankly, from the way he managed time, the way he would rehearse, the way he would, everything he did was for a purpose, and you never felt like time was wasted, and you always felt like you were able to play at the top level with all the energy.
How many sessions did you sit on with John, Malcolm, where you played it down in the beginning and then you went, you could have gone to lunch at that point, because he really didn't get to you guys till after lunch.
Yeah, but when he did, there was a lot of takes sometimes on those action cues. Maybe as many as 15 or 10, 20, really vigorous.
But he saved your resources until he really needed them.
Yeah, well, it was nice. Well, he had always the best. 40, how many years? I don't know, about 40 years and 46 pictures. I was very blessed to be there, you know. He was the greatest and always prepared. That's what I noticed, always prepared as a conductor. He didn't miss anything.
Jim Thatcher has a great story about the solo in Jurassic Park. At the what point you were asked to play that?
Well, we'd recorded all day, and by this time I was pretty much on my teeth. And he said, "Oh, Jim, I've got one more thing for you to do here," and that was that ba-dee-da-da solo. And I got through it, but it wasn't like John expected you to to be able to produce the goods. He also had a sense of humor that we didn't often see. But he wrote a solo for me for a picture called JFK, which was a cappella horn for about a minute, and then the strings came in with one of his greatest pieces of composition.
Arlington,
but yeah. I was close friends with John's brothers, Jerry and Don, and especially Jerry. And Jerry says, "Oh, I have a story for you, Jim." I said, "What's that?" He says, "Well, I called John the other night about this JFK solo." And I said, "Hey, John, what are you doing?" And John said, "Oh, I'm just putting the last nail in Jim Thatcher's coffin." So, take that for what it's worth.
That's great.
Well, if you don't mind, Jim, let's hear one of your, maybe one of the most iconic solos of you, Jim, that you play for John Williams. And that was, I think, the first movie you did with John as first chair horn, which is Always. You had an incredible solo in that movie. And this is probably one of the toughest horn solo ever written for the movies. So let's hear a little bit of this solo for the movie Always.
As we would have said, Jim, mark that solo.
I hope you heard the beautiful trumpet playing at the end of that solo. That was Malcolm McNab.
Yes, the high. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. And I also, you know, it's very kind you should mention this, but I often think to myself, if the great Vince DeRosa would have played this solo, he would have toyed with it. I love that man. And he was the great inspiration for me. I used to sit next to Vince when I was his second horn on various projects, and sometimes I would lose my place because I was so astounded by how beautifully he played and how easily he made things sound an octave above what I was playing. And I'd go, how on earth is he doing this?
Well, Vince was a great inspiration for all of us.
Yes.
He was first horn at Fox when I was under contract there. And I was under contract for the last 2 years of the contracts. And I heard Vince play many solos and played the lead line. And never once in 2 years did I hear Vince miss a note on a French horn. That is unbelievable.
I know, I believe it. I was playing in the Phoenix Symphony. I was just out of college and won an audition there. And we had a Christmas party. And we're all, you know, laughing and eating food and clanking dishes and putting on, you know, Eugene Ormandy and the Philadelphia Orchestra, this and that. And somebody put on Henry Mancini, Silent Night, Vince DeRosa. You could have heard a pin drop. Nobody talked. Nobody ate. It was that mesmerizing. And I'd listened to Vince when I was 12 years old. I went to the Warner Cinerama and heard How the West Was Won, and that sort of ruined me for the rest of my life. But I just said to myself then, I have got to get to know this man and find out what he does. And so it was my honor to be able to call him and have him teach me and show me things that helped me throughout the rest of my career. He also had a great sense of humor. I took a man named Dale Clevenger, who played principal horn with the Chicago Symphony, and a girl named Sarah Willis, who was in the Berlin Philharmonic. We had a horn convention, and the three of us went over to Vince's house. This is about 5-6 years ago. And Vince said, oh, you're Dale Clevenger. I love your horn playing. This is Sarah. Oh, very nice to meet you. And then Vince looked at me, and he got a twinkle in his eye, and he pointed at my stomach. Because I was overweight. And I looked at him and said, hey, I'm holding it in. And he goes, yeah, but I caught you when you were relaxing.
No, that on October 5th, he turned 101.
Yes. Vince. Yeah. I could go on this whole Zoom meeting and just talk about the great Vince DeRosa. He was an inspiration for us all.
He set the tone for horn playing.
Yes, he
forever.
Did.
Yeah, we listen to old Westerns and things now, and the horn section is like a Gunsmoke, so you probably did some of them, but there is a sound that came with Vince at the head of that section. Yeah, and for his 100th birthday, as long as we're spending the time doing this, you know, Jim, that horn players from all of over the world put together it was a Zoom or something to wish him happy birthday.
Every place I've been in the world, they asked about, did I know him? Every horn player.
I gave a clinic at Rice University, which has one of the great horn programs in the world now. And I sat down, and the first question they said was, tell us about Vince DeRosa.
And I think even John himself said during, I think it was a convention or something that was celebrating Vince a few years ago. And he even said, like, everything I know about the French horn, I learned from Vince DeRosa. And I think that John himself is very, very humble when it comes to these things. He's always the flex to the greatness of the players, like all of you. I mean, how many times he had some of you credited on even on the soundtrack albums as a soloist sometimes, and it's always fantastic to hear not just the greatness of the single player but all the orchestra together. And to explicate even better all of this, I would like everyone to hear another brief music excerpt where all the band, all of you, I think all of you played in this score, which is Jurassic Park, maybe save for Richard, perhaps, who was already conducting back then. And
Richard and I did this a couple of weeks ago.
but of course, but he actually conducted it live to picture, also in concert for John's music so many times. So this is a piece that is now very popular. John even performed it very recently in Berlin with his debut with the Berlin Philharmonic. And the audience went crazy when they heard this piece, but he also mentioned the fact that he wanted to point out how great the players in Los Angeles are. And I think this piece is a testament to the greatness of all of you, with that incredible trumpet sound coming from Malcolm McNab and the whole section. So let's hear a very brief piece from Jurassic Park.
Louise, the guy sitting behind you was also playing that. Bernie.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Come into the room.
Behind him back there, he was your second trumpet player, I think, for a long time, wasn't he?
Yeah.
In March, we do a film music series with Chicago Symphony. We're in our 17th season. We've done all of John's films, but we have coming up in March, Jurassic Park. The entire score with the film. And as I hear that music, I get excited and I start to sweat. And last time I was in Chicago talking with different people, they talk about how excited they are to do that score. But let me say one real quick thing that's been on my mind just listening. One of the things, besides all the technique and all the musicality and all of that went on with John's sessions, John set a tone for working with people where everybody wanted to make the music as good as it can be because they cared about him, they cared about his vision. And I remember sitting in the section and I was just a kid when I started working on films for him. And I made it a point to go up and say hello to some of the musicians in the other sections because I was so in awe and I just want to say, John, I'm so glad to meet you. Everybody was so nice. And the feeling in the room was always a positive one. There was a challenge. I mean, it was pretty intense, but there was always this feeling among the musicians and between the musicians and John of mutual respect and sort of a desire and a passion to make it really, really great because you wanted it to be that for the music and for John. And he set that tone, but the musicians also set the tone in the room. So That's one of the reasons I think his music is so great on all the films, because of that.
Yes.
The concentration level in order to deliver what he requires of you is enormous. And you don't want to fail. You just don't.
Yeah, it was always very special to work for John. It was more than a recording session. It was truly an event when you did one of his movies. And we were all very appreciative, because we all have high standards, but he was so detailed and wanting to keep raising the standard. Alfred Newman did the same thing. Alfred Newman would take one cue and rehearse it all day because he wanted it done so well. They couldn't afford
it. He could afford to do that.
Yeah.
Couldn't afford it later, but in the old days, when they had more money, that's what they were doing. That feeling carried on. Of excellence.
No, I was just going to say, you know, when you say about the room and being in the room and how special it was, it's so key, you know, specifically that cue example we just heard, you know, the room noise of Sony Pictures scoring stage, of Sean Murphy as well, I think we should credit. It's an incredible sounding score, Jurassic Park. You know, you play beautifully, and that's the key reason, but the actual sound, you know, that recording, and recently it was remastered by a friend of ours, Mike Mattesino, as part of a box set. I mean, do you, as professionals, do you sometimes listen, you know, to these scores, does it stand out to you, you know, some scores more than others about how good they sound, you know, the finished album?
I don't know that I've heard a lot of the finished albums. However, I got just because of how much I had to do in War Horse, I did get the CD for that ahead of having seen the movie. And I could follow the movie in my head without having seen it. The music was so descriptive that you could just know what was going on. And that has stuck with me. I mean, that's a real gift. To be able to do that.
I want to hear now a brief excerpt from that score, War Horse, where there's the beautiful lyrical flute solo by Louise Di Tullio. So let's hear a very short excerpt from Louise Di Tullio's solo for War Horse.
Beautiful.
Sheridan was my first real teacher, and you gave me a great foundation. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. You know that, I'll make this story brief, but her dad was over at the house, and my dad was a musician and orchestra manager. And he said, I have a daughter that plays the flute. She's 12 years old. And he knew I was studying the flute. So I went on and on about how good my teacher was. And he looked at me, he said, would you give my daughter some lessons? And I said, well, okay. I'd never taught before. And it was Louise. And so went on for a couple of years. Then I was in Vegas doing a show. So I sent her to my teacher. I figured, well, he had a lot to teach me. He certainly can teach her. And so that was the transition right there.
Speaking of the importance of being a teacher, you pass it on.
Yeah.
You pass it along.
Yeah. Of course, I'm talking about great teachers and great friends, great musicians. Mine was Tommy Johnson, who was his tuba player before me, and he did so many great things in the movie. And the movie Jaws, we might know the story, but it's a tuba, terribly difficult tuba part. And he came in cold after being late teaching school or something, and sight read it without, and it was perfect. And I knew it was hard. We've all played it. The tuba players have played it in the overture. But we did it at the Hollywood Bowl a couple of years ago live. And I couldn't believe that same solo kind of thing happened about 40 times. Real high. And that's what Tommy did. Tommy put so much into his music. And he's my mentor, like Vince was to Jim and others here. So,
by the way, Jim, that day when he came in through the door late, obviously, walked all the way. John waited till he got to his chair. Are you ready? Right into it. No warm up. Barely had the mouthpiece in the tuba. And he played it.
That thing scares tuba players all over the world now.
Yes.
I told that story on our podcast, I think you remember, Maurizio, but
yes.
He was late because of one of those legendary LA rainstorms, which basically almost shut down the 405, and he was coming from the valley. And so he came in, you know, bedraggled, wet, and frantic, because you know what it's like if you're going to be late for a session, you almost have a heart attack because it's never done. And he walked right into that and then just played the hell out of it all day. It was amazing. And if we're talking about mentors and teachers, I don't know if we've ever mentioned Artie Kane on any of these things, but Artie played keyboard for John before I did. And he was a legendary keyboard player in town and a mentor to me, and who's still with us at, I think, 95 years old.
Yeah, he wrote a great book recently. It's a very good book he wrote recently.
Which it is a great book. Music, yes, in
it is. It is.
Yes.
And he actually conducted Jurassic Park, which we just heard, didn't he? He conducted a lot of the sessions.
For John. In fact, one of his stories, I think he tells it in the book also, is that he got a call out, woke him out of bed in the morning saying, you know, John's got a bad back. Can you come in and conduct? And he had to like scramble down and do it. And that started a whole new career for him. He conducted for a lot of composers after that.
Yes. And talking about challenging solos, challenging parts, Ralph, I think that we have to mention again your absolutely wonderful solo in E.T. So what can you remember about that day? I mean, opening up the book and seeing what you had to perform, which was like, you know, something, I guess, very challenging at first sight.
Well, my story, which I've probably told too many times now, but we should... being as we're on video, John, it started 2 weeks before. Actually, I was playing a TV show at Fox. I think it was a MASH. John Parker, one of those. You know, we did a lot of television there. But John had his writing office at Fox, and he came on the stage during a 10-minute break, and we kind of were chatting. He said, "You're going to be with me in a couple of weeks." I had no idea what it was. I said, "Yeah." He says, "Oh, great! I'll write something for you." And that was the last I heard of it until I got to the date, and it turned out to be the ET sessions. And, you know, you kind of look through the book to see if there's anything that's going to get your attention there. And I look and I suddenly see a lot of notes.
A busy
and so I'm scuffling around on every 10. I'm kind of trying to, and comes to the lunch break. And I think this may be the day that I'm not going to make it. You know, but I'll be able to play these notes, but to actually make this a piece of music, it may be the day that I fail. So I went up to the podium to John. I said, "John, I see you've written something for me." This was the before the time where you could see the music ahead of time or anybody even thought to give it to you. And he said, "Yeah." I said, "Are you going to do that today?" He said, "No, we'll do that Thursday." And this was Tuesday. And I just went, "Oh, thank you." I took it home and practiced it.
Yeah. And so let's hear that wonderful, wonderful solo of Ralph playing the end credits of E.T. the Extraterrestrial.
Thank you.
Again, more trumpets as well.
And Vincent DeRosa playing for horn. Those horns were done by Vincent DeRosa.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful.
You know, I should take a moment here to say, yes, for John, it was always special. But for me, and probably a lot of us, we worked a lot of sessions that weren't John Williams, and sometimes the composers weren't up to that level of playing. But it didn't matter, because every day I went to work, I got to hear these people, and I got to play with these people. And it's, you know, that's really what was special about it.
Well said.
Absolutely, yes, because I think that, and the other thing is that how much, at least for me, after years of listening to this music and loving it, of course, but, you know, putting a name and a face to that kind of musicianship has been one of the greatest joys, at least in these recent years when I started this project, The Legacy of John Williams. And I think that this is something that really helped a lot of other fans, not just to focus on the music as a, something abstract, but something, it's something very human, something very made by people, real people, not by machines or just in the air somewhere. You know, the emotions are high because it's from the performer, you know, composer, performer, listener. This is something John Williams loves to say about how music is really the nexus of these three elements. For music to be able to function, you have these three ingredients work together. And this is another, I think, example of why his music has been so iconic for decades now. It's because it has been played by people like you. And I want to bring in another, I think, a legendary solo here, the one that Jim Self played in Close Encounters. So Jim, do you remember that specific day where you had to play the iconic Voice of the Mothership solo?
Well, it's kind of a studio story. I mean, I'm the luckiest guy in the world because Tommy Johnson, John's tuba player at the time, was on vacation. And I get a call and there are four people showed up, two oboes and a tuba and a contrabassoon. And we played in unison and we came out at the end of that day. They tried to make some other versions of it, but it didn't sync up with the movie. And luckily it helped my career a whole lot. And I didn't realize it at the time how iconic it would be or how important, but the idea that Spielberg and Williams would come up with the idea of communicating with aliens by music, which is good sense. The overtones are in nature. And I'm so lucky and happy I had this opportunity. I really worked for him, by the way.
Wow. What a debut.
I may have been a second tuba to Tommy on a couple films before that, but I didn't really know him or anything.
Yeah, and music was absolutely an essential ingredient, as you were saying, in this movie, because it was part of the story, a part of the sense of the story. So let's see that brief sequence from Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
Play the five tones.
Give her
six quavers, then pause.
She sent us four quavers, a group of five quavers, a group of four semi-quavers.
The only thing these phrases have in common are five, six.
I hope somebody's taking all this down.
What are we saying to each other?
It seems they're trying to teach us a basic tonal vocabulary.
It's the first day of school, fellas.
Take everything from the ladies.
Five, two,
follow her pattern. Note three.
We have a translation airlock on their audio signal. We're taking over this conversation now.
I have to give a shout out to John Ellis, who was the oboist there, and
oh, yeah.
John Williams absolutely loved his playing. And John Ellis left town. I couldn't tell you what year anymore, but I think his wife got tired of him being so busy and never home. my opinion, but John's, if he could still have John, he would be thrilled. He never. No matter how good the players were who came in, he always missed John.
John was an absolute genius. I worked a lot with John Ellis, and he was incredible. But one of the most admired musicians I've ever worked with John Ellis.
I was in the Peter Marienbloom California Junior Symphony with John. We were kids, and I remember thinking, you know, this guy was destined for greatness as an oboist, and nice guy. To give you a tiny bit of perspective about that solo, I had the honor of conducting the film about 3-4 years ago with the New York Philharmonic. We did multiple performances, and I remember going over to Alan Baer, the tuba player in the New York Phil, before the rehearsal, about 20 minutes before, and I saw him over there intently, and that's an understatement, looking at the music. And I went over, I said, so how's it going? And he just looked up at me. He really couldn't say anything. He just kind of stared and just kind of like this and looked back and started practicing again. So that he was brilliant. He played it brilliantly. But just a little perspective on what that part really called for. And he had to do it live. So,
well, you know, the every note you hear in the tuba is doubled in the contrabassoon. Norman Hirschberg was the contrabassoon player. I'm trying to think of the other oboe player, because every note was doubled in the oboe. The voice of the mothership with the tuba and the contrabassoon. I forgot, he taught at USC. Come on, somebody help me.
Oh, Bill Chris.
Bill Chris, yes. And anyway, and the other thing about this episode is that it was a pre-score. It was done in June of 1976. The film came out in 77. And all the scoring was not done until the spring of 77. And he used three tubas on that part of it. But anyway, it's a very unusual thing to have a pre-score.
Yeah, I remember in the sessions, there was no picture on the screen. They didn't, as I recall, they didn't want, Steve Spielberg didn't want people to see the aliens and all that. So it was leader. It was just like flies, you know, on the screen and streamers going by with no visual.
This is the first time I've ever seen it. I'm kicking myself. It's really interesting.
the notes all triggered a certain pitch, like an A flat would trigger a pink note on that computer or whatever was on the screen there. And that was the syncing that they had. It was very difficult to change it once it was recorded. It was almost like a whole bunch of little cues that we did. It wasn't all done in one piece like it sounds now.
The other part of it is that the chorus, John wrote the most fascinating chorus part because they weren't actually singing. They were doing vocal sounds. And I remember rehearsing the chorus in New York, and they were all looking at me saying, well, what's this supposed to sound like? I said, it's in John's head. We just have to try to make it happen here. And they did. And it just extraordinary choral writing, you know, that he did on that.
It was nominated for Academy Award, and it lost to another one that he scored called Star Wars One.
That's right. That's right.
Personally, I think it's the better score, but all his scores are great. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. And speaking about, you know, challenging parts for a musician, I'm reminded of a beautiful cadenza that Sheridan had to play in a movie called The Witches of Eastwick, which is in 1987. And that is a very strange score for John because it's very comedic, but also kind of scary, or it has some very menacing sound. But at the same time, it has some beautiful lyric writing. And you, Sheridan, played a wonderful cadenza in that score. Do you remember anything about, again, getting the score on the stage and saying,
well, wow. No, it wasn't difficult technically, but musically, it was difficult like most pieces are. And I had to figure out some way to make it sound beautiful. It had a little bit of a Debussy sound to it, sort of. So I had to figure out what kind of a lyric interpretation I would put on the solo. That was the real problem.
Let's hear a little bit of that beautiful solo by Sheridan.
I thank you for teaching Stephanie. she loves you so much.
Well, Stephanie, that's Malcolm's daughter. Yeah. And I was talking to her yesterday, and because I was so worried about this being going well today that I called Stephanie. My wife suggested I call her, but she does a lot of Zoom teaching. So she was very, very, very useful today. She helped me make sure that it would all go well. I'm no technical wizard at all. I get scared by things like this.
I'm curious, all the great soloists who were here, they're all soloists. How was it as a soloist working with John, with what kind of input he gave or didn't give when he wrote a solo for you? Did he immediately, before you played, did he offer something or did he just let you go with it? Or how did that work?
I don't ever recall him telling me how to play anything. I think
I don't either.
I think he left that up to the performer, which is logical. If you try to micromanage a person's solo, it ruins it. The best thing to do is just turn them loose and let them do whatever
they do. John was primarily a pianist. And so my experience was probably a little different. I can remember on numerous occasions with John where not just the ET solo, but where there would be some little tricky passage that he'd written and on a tenor or something, he would maybe come over and say, you know, I can't play anything at all anymore. I can't move my fingers, but it sort of goes like this, you know, and then he would just ruin it. Say, oh yeah, right. So something like this, I can't do it, but you know, you'll do.
I just remember an occasion, and I won't name names, that there was a big solo, and John wasn't getting quite what he wanted. He never said a word, never made a suggestion. He just tried it over and over and over again. And it had been perfect every time. There was absolutely nothing wrong with it that I could see and or hear. And on this, when I finally listened to a CD, I knew what the problem was. Never picked it up in the room. It was very interesting. But he also never made a suggestion as to what. I'm not even sure you could describe it. But it was interesting. He just trusted his musicians and he got the best he could and moved on.
And I'm thinking also about the scores like Hook. I mean, because Hook was probably a very tough job for all of you because it was lots of music, lots of solos, lots of big orchestra pieces. So I think you, Louise, had a very special role in that score. You had some incredible moments, both lyrical and virtuosic. So do you remember? Because I see that, I think Ralph sent me a very nice drawing that Steven Spielberg made during the Hook session, where you can see a drawing of John standing up with a baton saying Tutti, but the orchestra is kind of drawn out. Basically, all of you were kind of collapsed under the busyness of the music. I mean, I guess it was for all of you that played, because Jim Thatcher was there, Jim Self was there, Ralph was there, and Malcolm was there. So you were basically all on that magnificent score. So what do you remember about those sessions?
The first thing I remember is walking in, opening the book, and just going, oh my God. I'm not going to do this.
It's quite polite.
It was very difficult, especially sight reading, and no time to ever learn anything. And for the most part, the woodwinds didn't get a whole lot of rehearsal. He would rehearse the strings and we were just fingering, trying to work the kinks out and hopefully get through it when you had to. But in that score, the lyrical solos were so much fun to play. Those were special, really special moments for me. And they went into my CD, as you know.
And basically you all had some kind of solo, or maybe more some prominent part, if not a solo, at least a prominent part, because Jim Self, you have a little solo at one point in Hook.
Yeah, it's right after, right before the food fight. The kids had a food fight in it, and it was one of those things where it wasn't in the stand in the morning, and we went out to lunch, and I came back, and I saw it there, but no chance to look at it. It was high and chromatic, and he calls it up first, no, and it scared the heck out of me, and I luckily got through it, but it was like 40 bars of strings and a tuba solo, and one of the ones I'm happiest about, by the way, because it was technically quite different than other things he may have written for me. Yeah.
Mm. And Malcolm as well has some fantastic trumpet playing in that.
Yes.
You know, especially the banquet cue, you know, all the triplets. Jim, you know, you've got that great solo as well, whenever the flowers sniffing Robin Williams bits.
Right, yeah, he was good at sniffing out there. Yeah.
It's virtuosic as we all know. And I was playing that in the background one afternoon, and my, you know, when I was a kid, and my parents, you know, heard it in the background, because I had the tape as a young kid, and they said, "What is that music? It's incredible." You know, Hook really wasn't a very big hit. You probably all know this. It was a bit of a flop, sadly. More so over here, I think. It may have been done better over there, but you know, no one really knew much about Hook. And if it wasn't for that music, and of course it being scheduled in many concerts all across the world, and of course it celebrates its anniversary this year, 30th anniversary. It's such an incredible score. It really is. I mean, did you feel that in the room? You must have, because of that wonderful drawing from Spielberg.
I went up to John about halfway through, and he was still up on the podium. We were starting our break, and I said to John, I said, "I'm having a great time today." And John looked down at me and said, "So am I."
You know, one of the challenges of doing his films live in concert is that in the studio we record 2 or 3 minutes, you know, in an hour, whatever it is. But when you put Jurassic Park or Star Wars in front of an orchestra and you have two rehearsals and then you have to play it through, and the way orchestras do it because of the cost and all, they'll do usually two or three, sometimes at Chicago we do four performances day after day of those films. It's really a matter of survival in a lot of ways, where a lot different than playing the score in the studio. I wish they would do Hook live in concert, but you know, I would recommend they have six trumpets and eight horns and you know.
Yes,
one of John's incredible talents is also writing lyrical parts, not just virtuosic or very difficult music, but also putting the musician in the spotlight through in quiet pieces. And I want to make you hear a piece from a little known score called Stanleyan Diaries, where we can hear some of Malcolm McNab's wonderful lyrical trumpet playing that he did for John. So let's hear a little bit of Stanleyan Diaries with a trumpet solo by Malcolm McNab.
You know, I really didn't get any solo parts except in that movie where, you know, it was a very small group. And what was unique about it, there was not the regular people were there. Two people from the Philharmonic were in the front line. And that was Janet Ferguson, I think, and Lauren Levy, was it, the clarinetist in the Philharmonic? So, you know, it was strange. I never worked with those guys before and I never saw them on any of the other calls. But I was surprised. That's as close as I got to being a soloist with John.
Yeah, and also it speaks about how some of the smaller movies sometimes are maybe special projects for him. Of course, we know Schindler's List, of course, you know, where the music it's not a small project because the movie was very big and important, of course, but, you know, the music was very chamber-like, and he puts a lot of thought and care, especially in picking the special moments for some musicians to be in the spotlight and having their moment to shine, like in the example we just heard. But maybe what John's music is also known for and beloved by so many people in the world is because of this wonderful, gorgeous orchestral sound that all of you contributed so crucially in many of his scores. And me and Tim prepared a very small tribute to all of you, which is from a score that I know that all of you are very fond of. It's not one of the big ones from John, but it was a very special project for him, because we know that he still loves that score, because he regularly conducts some of that music in concerts, even recently with the Berlin Philharmonic. And also special for all of you, because it was, by all accounts, from all you said in our previous podcast conversation, a very fun project, which is Far and Away, a movie from 1992 directed by Ron Howard, which told the story of two Irish immigrants coming to America and trying to set their own foot and grabbing their own piece of land to build their own future. So we will see the scene of the great Oklahoma land rush. It's an absolutely stellar piece of music and also an absolutely stellar piece of filmmaking. It was still the era without computers, without CGI. It's all shot in 65 millimeters. It feels very real, but it's the music that gives this epic feeling of grandeur, of excitement, of adventure. But even beyond that, it's the wonderful playing by his orchestra, which is, of course, all of you here, which really brings this real life to this scene. So let's see this sequence. It's a 5-minute sequence, and I hope you will all enjoy it. And the special thing here is that we isolated the music from the rest of the sounds. So it's just music and images, like a silent movie. So
your playing is allowed to be breathing as it should.
Yes. So let's hear this wonderful sequence.
Forget the horse, lad, and find yourself a donkey.
Joseph! Take him by the bit.
Shannon!
Thank you. can't pretend you're out of breath.
Pretend? My heart's up here in my nose.
Isn't that incredible?
I've got a sort of a story about this. I was just before this score was recorded, I was in Tucson, Arizona with John. He brought me down to play a benefit with the symphony because he couldn't get Tim Morrison out of the Boston Symphony to come play the solo that he did in JFK. It was the very first live performance of that score. And he brought me down there, but we stayed up in Ventana Canyon. And I heard him because he was in the room next to me. He had a piano in it, and I heard his music being written. Right next door. And we got there, and I got to tell you, it was the time of our life. What's the name of the famous Irish group that plays the traditional music?
Paddy Mahoney, the chief.
Paddy Mahoney, and not only that, but all the best tin whistle players and Ellen Pipes, all those people were there, and every 10-minute break was a jam session, and it was just wonderful. Do you guys remember that at all? That day, it was incredible. It was the most fun.
Paddy Maloney sadly passed away quite recently there, but we interviewed him last year, and he was so, you know, he treasured that moment. He treasured those sessions because, you know, he kind of, I think John Williams kind of said to him, just freestyle, just, you know, do your thing. And similar to just what you said, Malcolm, I mean, clearly that's what happened, you know, and it was all very natural, you know, and I think that's the effect he wanted to get, because essentially, of course, you know, it's an Irish story, you know. But no, it's an incredible cue. And that land race sequence is just, as I'm sure you all agree, is stunning, beautifully filmed.
It's Ireland meets the Old West.
Yes, that's right.
I'm an Irish citizen.
Yeah, I have a little anecdote about John that might be interesting to everybody. Later in my life, I started composing, and of course, I had listened to everything he wrote and took notes on sessions and stuff. But he and I used to take bag lunches together and eat at MGM. And also, when I played his concerto with the Pacific Symphony, we had rooms next to each other. I talked to him about composing. One of my questions with him was, "Do you ever rewrite things?" And he says, "I'm never happy." He's never happy. He says, "I've never been happy with anything I ever wrote."
There are concert suites that have been published by Hal Leonard that orchestras can do where John still makes changes. They're already out there and being done.
You know, we spoke to Sarah Willis yesterday from the Berlin Phil, and she gave a great story to us saying, you know, whenever they were having the rehearsals, basically because John Williams is so acute to the timings and everything, the Berlin Phil couldn't keep up saying, you know, he was going to say, "Right, we'll do this now." And all the players were going, "Oh, hang on, where's that music?" You know, obviously they're not used to doing film sessions, but it's similar to what you were all saying about him being so precise when it comes to, you know, the timing and on the clock.
But, you know, what is really lovely to when you have the opportunity, like in this occasion, to have the music isolated from the rest of the sounds, and is to pick how laborious is the work of the film composer. I mean, to catch all the various syncs. I caught really by watching it a couple of really lovely syncs. It's all so wonderful to hear that. And the composer had to take care of that thing, but also to be musical as well, because I think this piece, if we would listen to it without images, would be really a lovely piece of music even to perform at a concert. And I think you, Richard, should tell John to pull out this cue and do it in concert, because it would be magnificent, I think.
Well, I've done Far and Away. I've actually done the music from Far and Away with the RTE Orchestra in Dublin. Yeah. And they enjoyed it very much. But there is so much of his music that should be done in concert. I mean, it goes on. And he's continually making that possible through Hal Leonard and the wonderful Paul Lavender at Hal Leonard, releasing music for concert that orchestras can purchase, have in their libraries and play. So it's a continual kind of thing, which is great.
That is kind of a pet peeve of mine, because they do all of those arrangements, and not just for John, for like Jerry Goldsmith and things. all the solo things are left out. And there's some beautiful stuff that should go into concerts.
Well, sometimes, you know, The Face of Pan from Hook is one of my favorite pieces to do, and also Memoirs of a Geisha. Sometimes I think John sits down, he says, okay, I'll start with the flute. And he just, you know, off he goes. And there are these magnificent flute solos. And, but you're right, you know, but so, there's Lincoln, there's JFK. I just did Born on the 4th of July with Michael Sachs in Cleveland. There is that music, but it's, there's so much to do. I mean, he could really, you know.
Yeah, but you know, I mean, it isn't all just a million notes, which is so much of what he gets into the concerts. There's just so much more that does get ignored, and it's too bad. Just a little tidbit. A few years ago, I was talking with John, and he never got into computers. His wife finally bought him a telephone. He was refusing because it is a big waste of time. He didn't want to be bothered with that. And I was kind of floored. I mean, he still writes all of those notes with pencil and paper. I don't know how it's possible. Just to write out a flute part would take hours, much less the whole thing in your head and getting it down.
And I think all of you also are very close to Steven Spielberg, because all of you participated in many of John's scores for Steven throughout the years. And all of you told me very similar stories about Steven sneaking in the session with his own camera or filming all of you while playing. So he knows all of you very well. So do any of you have some nice Steven Spielberg anecdote to tell here?
I had an experience in the sound booth. He was working on some animation for another film. And he was showing me how it's actually done, the expressions in the face. And it was just amazing that he even noticed, or, you know, just wanted to share. It was kind of fun. And I learned something. So it was always a question to me, how did they get the faces and the mouth and everything? So it's all plotted out with pins and things. And it would be a fascinating documentary to do, actually, to follow one of those, just a scene.
I loved his enthusiasm when he was in the orchestra with his movie camera. He was like a little kid in a candy store. He obviously loved what everybody was doing. And there's got to be a vault full of footage of all of us that I would love to see someday, because I remember him on almost every session, especially in the early ones. He was always around me filming everything I was doing, and everybody else in the orchestra as well. It'd be great to see.
Yeah, he loved to come to scoring sessions when we did Jaws. He came to the scoring session with a life jacket on.
Yes.
I forgot that.
I believe now Steven Spielberg actually joined the woodwind section clarinet for 1941, didn't he? Mm-hmm. The 1941 March, you remember that?
I was in the booth when Spielberg, we were doing War of the Worlds. And I told Spielberg, I says, you know, I was 10 years old when the one came out in 1953. And I says, it scared me. I had nightmares for a year. And he said, me too. So that inspired him to write a new version of it.
Do a lot of you know that there's a real great treasure trove of footage? I mean, especially the E.T. sessions, which John Toll filmed. You know, you can really see John Williams getting quite, you know, kind of frustrated because he couldn't get the sync points right. And then, of course, we all know the story of Spielberg re-editing to Williams' music.
And I think E.T. was another special project for all of you, because, again, I think all of you were there, more or less, for E.T. And that is another score where the music lifted the movie to a whole another level. Of course, it's a wonderful story of friendship and love, but it's the music that gives that airborne feeling of like really lifting. And I think the scene where the bikes finally fly over the moon is really one of the iconic J. John Williams' music pieces. And again, mostly because there is so much emotion in that scene because of the music and how it is played. And maybe to cap off our conversation, I want to make you see the wonderful bicycle chase from E.T. finale. And let's appreciate all of your wonderful playing.
Let's split up! Hey!
Incredible. That's a real lightning in the bottle recording there. Bruce Botnick recorded that score, and I think he deserves a shout out too. I mean, incredible sound and beautiful playing, beautiful writing. It's just outstanding. And it's so well mixed. You know, I mean, did you all see that in the cinema? I mean, did you must have all known that was such a special score because music was so key, pardon the pun.
We were probably out playing concerts. Going to movies.
So many movies that played we never saw. That's the unfortunate
part. No, fair. If you were there,
never at any time.
I don't think I ever saw this one.
You know, never. Really?
No.
I saw just a few of the movies I ever worked on.
I can tell you, conducting that sequence live, doing the entire film, symphony orchestras, you know, the players sometimes they look at it, there being a difference between the symphonic repertoire and film repertoire. But the first time I conducted this, I remember telling them, I said, it's going to be faster than you think it is. And we started. And at the end of it, I could just see them kind of sitting back in their chairs thinking, what happened? And it was like they were being pulled along through the whole sequence.
We had to sight read it, you know, and they had the music ahead of time. They could practice it.
But it also, there's so many high notes. I mean, you could hear, you know, Malcolm, it was likely you hitting that very high note on the trumpet right before the bikes goes over the start to lift off. I mean, you are one of the greatest high trumpet player in the world, I think, because...
Well, I haven't been that high. Richard had some tempos on the concerto para Mendez that were really pushing me. You remember that?
Yeah.
I couldn't get it.
I never saw you sweat before. That was the first time in my
life. It was two shows back to back. I felt like I'd been run over by a truck. That was tough. Plus you got the real artist up on the screen doing his thing and you have to emulate that.
You know, when you see that sequence that you just showed and you feel the emotion and the characterization, the music literally becomes a character in the film and is like describing everything going on and the characters and the musicians in the studios, I've always felt, aren't just technicians or even just musicians, but in a sense, they're directors, they're composers, they immerse themselves in what's happening. And you can see it in this sequence so incredibly that, you know, when you're on the violin, you can play high notes, but, you know, if you do that Alfred Newman vibrato or whatever, and you really go for the gold, it really translates into this tremendous emotion. And whether it's a flute, you know, flute solos or the trumpet solo or whatever, I mean, tribute to these folks.
When you're working, doing a scoring session, as opposed to doing a symphony concert, when you go to work at the studios, they have a time schedule. They have to get the job done and they have to get it done efficiently. So we're there to help them. We do everything in our power to make it go, make the job go. That's not true when you're sitting in an orchestra mindlessly playing. You're in the studio, you're trying to help get that production, get that job done. It's quite a different attitude. Everybody, they like each other or hate each other. They're all working together. Because you have to get the job done.
You also are painfully aware of the fact that it's not going away. So, you know, it can live on way beyond us for sure.
John inspired that. I mean, I only played on like five or six of his films, but my memory is that when you were in the room, you know, again, you wanted it to be great, and this was your job, and he was managing the time, and he was efficient in all of that. And within all of that, as Sheridan was saying, the musicians are, you know, the ingredients in the stew, and just so exciting.
And we did everything we could to make it go, make it work.
Sometimes there were passages we couldn't play, you know, just couldn't with that, especially with no time to practice.
Louise,
split things up and manage, you know, you do this, you do that, you do the other thing. And you know, there was a camaraderie and a cooperation, I know certainly in the flute section, that didn't really exist, not nearly in the same way as in a symphony orchestra. In my experience in the Philharmonic, particularly.
Louise, do you remember that time at MGM when we were sitting next to each other, and there was an incredibly difficult part that neither of us could play. So we looked at each other, was, how are we going to do this? So you played part of it, I played part of it, you played part of it, I played part of it. And we were able to get through it. That was the only way we could do it. And it had to be done.
I thought of that now that they're doing the striping and they can hear every single note you're playing. And how do you fix things when, you know, they can hear, you know, you're dropping out and somebody else is doing it.
That's right. But we actually did it work.
That'd be awkward.
Yeah.
That's real camaraderie.
Well, John was very well organized. Some of the film composers weren't. They'd write at the last minute and they'd scramble around and have all their orchestrators sitting around them. But John was organized and he write so many minutes a day. At least that's what I was told. And it shows, because you can get a lot more done that way and be much more efficient. And I think that's the way he always was.
And you were playing piccolo on E.T., Louise, right?
Yes.
All those high notes again. Yeah. It was all you.
All those fast high notes.
Yeah. I'm curious, the brass players, how did you handle all that you had to do and maintain the level of energy and, you know, just technically with everything going on through the session, like through 3 or 4 days of sessions, how did you manage that playing wise?
Paranoia.
Paranoia, right.
You just had to get the job done. I mean, in my case, Vince taught me fundamentally how to get through things and how to do things right. In fact, my first lesson with him, he said, let's talk about your lips or your embouchure. And I thought, boy, that's about as basic as it gets. But what he brought out, he actually ended up showing me what I was doing when I was having a good day. So wherever I go, I have a book, it's called Carved in Stone, about Vincent de Rosa. And it's got all his excerpts and his exercises in there, because that's how he and Richard Parisi, another great horn player, Jack Cave, who... that's for another story, but anyway, these are all great players who learned how to get the job done over and over again, day in and day out, and that's what was passed down to us.
You know, the famous trombone player Bill Olyate, or Lloyd Olyate, rather. Lloyd Olyate. He said, "You're either bored to death, which is most of the time, or you're scared to death."
Yes. It was 95.5%, wasn't it? 5%.
That's the difference between playing it live, a film like we do, like Richard does, and when we record in the studio, we do it in cues, and you don't play them back to back. It's hard. It would be hard to play something all the way back to back like you do in a concert. And so we have a lot of dead time that we can rest our chops, us brass players. I am so amazed at the trumpet and horn playing now and in my life in the studios, because I couldn't believe they could play all those high notes all day long. Vince, in the first Star Trek movie, Vince had these super high written E flats time after time after time after he'd worked 14 hours a day.
Right.
And then he'd go do a record session.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, it's a capital.
Sometimes that happens. We work around the clock, almost.
Pretty much.
And then we have to mention again another legendary player that sadly is no longer with us, Emil Richards, who played also in a zillion scores for everyone, and also many of John's scores, including I think E.T., Jurassic Park, and many others. I think Ralph, you were friends with Emil, if I'm correct.
Oh yeah,
I think we all must have known him.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was great. Wonderful. Sweet man.
Emil was funny.
He was crocheting once. He made me an honorary Italian with it and knitted me a little crocheted hat. In a drawer somewhere.
There was a gong show, a television show once. I don't know if you remember it, but you know, funny things would happen. And Emil showed up and he wore a little Andean hat. And he had a rain stick, and they played the music to Falling Leaves. And as they did that, he could just turn the stick up. And that was the only thing he did. He had a great sense of humor.
He and Tommy Tedesco. Tommy Tedesco went on the Gong Show once dressed in a tutu.
That's right. And he played, I Used to Be Number One.
Right.
And we watched it at Universal. Everyone stopped playing. They put a TV set there. We watched Tommy on the Gong Show. in the ballet costume.
Tommy Tedesco was, we were at Taddeo one day, and we were taking a break, a 10-minute break. Tommy Tedesco didn't dress very well. He had an old beat-up T-shirt, some baggy pants. And then he was standing next to Arnold Koblenz, who dressed like a, you know, like a salesman. He looked beautiful, and he was. He was a realtor. But he was a wonderful oboist. He played a lot of solos and oboes. And these two guys were talking to each other. It was a study in contrast. And what if I take a picture? And Tommy looked at me and said, he said, wait a minute. And he had some coffee. And he took it and he spilled it all over his T-shirt or his sweatshirt. And now he's taking a picture.
Hey, Malcolm, you remember the Tons of the Pioneers.
How could I forget? you were one of them. Yeah, we had.
I was. You had to be over 200 pounds.
I remember that.
It was, yeah, it was a group of musicians weighing between 200 and 450 pounds, dancing and singing to a track that we had made, and we actually opened for Randy Newman at one of the RMA parties. You remember that?
Wonderful.
He missed it.
You know, a lot of people ask about studio players. And how do you get through the stress? How do you walk into a session and there's Hook or E.T. or Jaws sitting in front of you? And how do you deal with that? Well, you're kind of seeing it here. The sense of humor in the studio was something that when I first started playing, I thought this is going to be really, I got to be serious, you know. And there was just this lightness at times, you know, it was sort of like taking the pressure off. And this is a prime example of kind of what it was like. Be serious when you're serious. And relax, and that's how you get through it.
I remember
it's
a story.
Gone away.
Yeah.
Yes, it has.
And it is too bad because I don't think they ever understood that they had a room full of people with ADD, very creative people, and that kind of goes along with it. And you need a release valve. So and the times when they're busy in the booth, it'd be pandemonium in the room. But the minute the composer was back on the stand and conducting, it was all business. They got great product.
But I think one of the things about John Williams, you could always sense that he appreciated the fact that the musicians were bringing his music to life. There was always that attitude that there's not a sound until they play it.
He was very grateful when you did something for him that he liked. He's very appreciative. He always was.
But also, I think some of the composers had also some sense of humor. Also, Jerry Goldsmith was very fun. Some of you, I think it was you, Jim Thatcher, you told me one story about the score Sleeping with the Enemy, in which Louise has an amazing flute solo as well, where, you know, the melody started to remind you of maybe of a classical piece, and you were starting to look at each other.
Well, the melody was ba da 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 da, and it reminded us of the second movement of the Rachmaninoff Second Symphony, and so we kind of got, we're kind of breathing Rachmaninoff underneath, and Jerry just said, "Shut up, you guys." But Jerry and I, we had a great relationship. I always tried to use a Wagner tuba because we got that would show up on our pensions, and we got a little overscale. Jerry would make fun of me again.
Very
so
true.
One day I brought my Wagner tuba in, and he said, "Jim, turn your tubing towards me." So I turned the bell towards him, and he picked up lemon drops on the podium and started throwing them across the into my bell.
There was a wonderful viola player named Sam Bogosian, just a fabulous player, and a composer friend of mine, Lee Holdridge, wonderful composer, said that he decided to do a little practical joke. So he wrote a viola solo that was basically unplayable. It was just a page with black notes and all that sort of thing. And he put it in Sam's book, and Sam would always get there early to look, see if there was a solo. And the word went around, we were all kind of watching Sam, and Sam sat down, he opened his book, and you just saw his eyes go like this, and the sweat, and he starts like this. And he thought that he was in for big trouble. But things like that, just little things, you know.
Elmer Bernstein did that to Dorothy Remsen. She came into this, she came in and she opened her book and she started, she was practicing and practicing every break. She's practicing and practicing. He finally calls that cue and she almost played it. She just came with it and that's eyelash. He was amazed. And then he told her that it was a gag.
And I think Malcolm, you told me a story, a similar story with Michael Kamen, I think. It is.
Yeah, it was Tommy Johnson, the tuba player, was right down here. And we had a couple of things. And I had someone call him one time and set up something funny, you know. And he was going to get me back. Well, he talked to a guy that was sitting at the music desk, at the editing desk, and about writing something for me. And he brought it back to the stand, put it on the stand. I came back. And I opened this thing, and he said, well, leave the brass out right now. We'll just do it. And I saw oboe solos, and I got fortissimo. On the highest notes you can imagine. And I mean, it was nonstop of the most ridiculous stuff you'd ever have to play. And you go, what? And then all of a sudden he says, are you ready, Malcolm? And I said, I have to go to the bathroom. It was a big joke, you know, and then I got it autographed and it's a precious treasure right now.
There used to be a piano player called Ray Turner. He worked at Disney and they did the same thing to him. They wrote some impossibly difficult piano part. And he went through his book and he was practicing it all day. Of course, it was a joke.
Those are the things you remember. These are the great things we remember, really the fun we had.
If you're a brass player in the studios, you better have a sense of thick skin because the sarcasm was deep and right aimed at you. If you missed a note in a rehearsal, I'm sure Malcolm would let you know in a very fun way, but it was really fun. He'd say he'd pick on the horn section all the time.
All of it. We deserved it.
Yeah,
that's when right. He sat on the other side of the room.
one of the things with sessions is there's so obviously it's all strictly behind closed doors and some of it's all very secretive, but there are some wonderful stories. There really are, and it's been a real pleasure and treat to hear from you and to see you and speak with you also. Thank you so much for spending this time with us and to share with our audience.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
Thank you for doing this.
Great. I'd like to say one quick thing. Just a little tidbit about Tim Burton, my good friend, Tim Burton. Tim is not just somebody who does interviews and all that. Tim's father, John Burton, was one of the greatest French horn players in film music. He played on Lawrence of Arabia, the Bond films and all that. So Tim has this passion for music that is not just his own passion, but he experienced it throughout his life with his father being one of the greatest musicians and all. So Tim, you understand all of this completely.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, very much. I mean, Richard and I are sort of really on the same page with this, this whole project. It's been wonderful speaking with musicians and, obviously growing up in a musical household and with, a French horn player as a father, he would always, be listening out to Jim's playing, for Vince's playing. Over here, it would be, David Cripps and Hugh Seenan, David Pyatt, Richard Watkins, such a wonderful tradition of horn playing. It was, and obviously paying attention to the music for all sections, not just French horn, of course, all of you as well, and it's just incredible. And I think this project is so special and it's so important to highlight the musicians who bring the music to life at the end of the day. I know it sounds a bit corny, but it's true.
How many people here in this panel hearken back to a father in the reason they're musicians? I'm one. I remember Ralph saying it on a panel. Certainly Sheridan, Thatcher. Anybody else?
My father was in the clothing business, but he put music in our lives from the very beginning. And so even though he wasn't a professional musician by any means, he brought that into our home from the beginning.
As I've heard all of these things in a couple of these videos that I've done. Fathers are hugely instrumental. If anybody thinks they just go to work and bring the paycheck home, I just want to point that out because I think it's really important and very fascinating to me. And Tim, I never would have guessed.
Louise, my dad said no one ever makes a living playing a trumpet. So I ended up in a projection, a theater projection, just like him. I went to work with him. And I remember the first time I was running movies with him over in, can't remember the place what it was, but it was, I saw one film like 23 times in a week. And it was Manny Klein was playing taps in the movie. I didn't know it at the time, but I thought, that's when I said, God, there's actually some people playing instruments behind this. And so he says, no, never mind that. You got to be a projectionist. So I was a theater projectionist for a while. But I kept practicing.
Well, I just wanted to point that out because I think it's just fascinating.
Thank it's you. Crucial. It's crucial. Absolutely. Also, the mentorship that all of you got from your previous esteemed colleagues like Jim Thatcher with Vince DeRosa and Malcolm from the great Juan Racy.
Juan.
Absolutely. And Ralph from RDK. So, and Jim Self with Tommy Johnson. So there is this great lineage of musicianship that goes, that the torch has been passed from one generation to the other.
I'd like to say one thing, that I feel incredibly privileged to have worked with such great musicians my entire career. And I couldn't believe it. I went under contract at Fox when I was only 20, how good the players were. I was just astounded. I go to work and I said, I don't believe what I'm hearing. They were the best in the world. And they'd have an orchestra of great jazz musicians and great classical musicians amalgamated together into an orchestra. I just couldn't believe my ears.
And I think we all learned from one another too, Sheridon.
Yeah.
You know, on the job and the difference between playing in a philharmonic symphony orchestra and going to the studios. It was so much more fun and more challenging in the studios. You know, we got to know the symphony repertoire, and I think that's what I wanted to do when I started out. I think I'd have died. It just needed the challenge and the daily inspiration and challenge. Yeah, I just needed the challenge. It's been a great way to live.
One of your first experiences was with an aging Stravinsky, wasn't it, Louise?
Correct. Is that right? He was quite old. Sheridan did some of those too.
I can tell you an interesting story there. You were talking about John Williams and changing notes. Well, Louise and I and about three or four other people were recording at the Columbia Studios, recording studio, a chamber music piece by Stravinsky, and Stravinsky was conducting. And as he was conducting his piece, he was changing the notes constantly. Oh, I don't like this note. I'm going to put this note in.
I guess that's forgotten that, Sheridan. You
know? Wow.
That's incredible.
Incredible. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I really want to thank all of you. I mean, I would go for another hour or two just hanging out with all of you.
Oh, yeah.
No, thank you, Maurizio. Thank you.
But I really want to thank every one of you, singularly Sheridon, Malcolm, James, Self, Jim Thatcher, Richard, Rolf, all of you, thank you very much, because this was very, very special for me. You know, this is kind of a culmination of the work I've been doing so far with talking with all the musicians. I know that a lot of other musicians probably should be here talking with us. It would be very crowded and very difficult to manage, but maybe we can do a part two in the future with other guests, the fantastic players that play for John and for many other composers for so many years. So I really want to thank all of you for joining us, me and Tim, for this wonderful, wonderful conversation that we had.
If you're going to do a part two, then make sure that, you know, the people who succeeded me were Chet Swiatkowski and Gloria Chang and Randy Kerber. There are a lot of great musicians out there who are still carrying on that tradition.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm in touch with a few of them, Gloria and Randy. I'm in touch with them. I'm in touch with also with other great, great musicians who still carry on this tradition, fortunately, of wonderful playing.
I'd like to say that Maurizio particularly is, we appreciate your fluency in English, because you talk to us just like, conversation. And
well, thank you. I appreciate that. I really want to make sure that I I'm understood by everyone. You know, I'm
oh, you
everyone.
Are.
So, guys,
I
really,
go on for hours.
Thank you, all of you. Thank you, all of you. I will go on for another hour, really. Thank you very much, all of you. Thank you, team, for co-hosting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
It was absolutely lovely. Thank you, all of you.